Cross River. It's so exciting and happy to be back with you on the program Security Alert, the program that seeks to educate you, inform you about different security issues. Yes, we tend to create the kind of awareness you need to have. Now, security is of topmost priority. It's so important in every facet of life. I mean, from individuals to institutions to cities to state and even the nation at large is saddled with security challenges. How do we curb the security issues we have in the nation at large? Well, we have distinguished people here in the studio who will be talking to us about something that is of priority and of paramount importance to us as a people, as a state, and as a nation. I'm talking about the establishment of a state police. But in the meantime, I'd like you to join me as I make welcome my esteemed guest on the program Security Alert. I'm going to start from my left. I have the state security advisor to Cross River State Government in person of Mr. Ekwene Bassey. It's good to have you on the program, sir. Welcome.
Thank you very much. I'm good to have yours.
Welcome to the show. And I also have Honorable John Gall Lebo. He's a member representing Abbey State constituency. It's good to have you in the studio, sir.
Thank you.
Welcome to the program Security Alert. Our focus for today is the establishment of a state police. But before we talk about a state police, let's have the background knowledge of how the police force came into being, talking about the federal police force. State Security Advisor, sir.
Thank you, Wolfgang. Let me do just a brief overview of the history of the Nigerian Police Force. It all began in 1861 in Lagos, when the Consular Guard was established, by the British colonial authorities back in Lagos then. By 1863, it metamorphosed into what was then called the Hausa Guards, made up of about 30 captured or 30 freed Hausa male slaves who formed, the core human factor of, that Hausa Guard. And then in 1876, the Constabulary of Lagos was also established via an ordinance that was consented to by the colonial authorities back in England. And then it just went on like that until 1896, when the Lagos Police Force was also established. But in 1891, certain states which presently, then they were called the Oil River States, or Oil Rivers Territory. And presently, they call it Niger, Niger Delta region. And at one point, they were the Niger Coast area. Also formed a police force for the policing and law enforcement activities within the region. But then in 1888, the Royal Niger Company, which had its headquarters in Lokoja, also formed the Royal Niger Police Force, which was headquartered there. At some point, there was a convergence of that, because what was then the Lagos Police became better organized by 1906. And so there was a convergence of all these various forces, such that by 1930, the Lagos Police Force, the Niger Coast Constabulary, and the Royal Niger Police Force all were merged together and then metamorphosed into the Nigerian Police Force with an Inspector General of Police. Of course, you are aware that before then, by 1914, there had been the amalgamation of the Northern Southern Protectorate. And then by 1960, Nigeria became an independent nation. So we had the Independence Constitution, which provided for the establishment of the Nigerian Police, and then the Republican Constitution in 1963. Suffice it to say that at that point we had the Native Authority Police and local government police, and they performed quite well until the coup in 1966 and the intervention of the military into the politics, and then those different formations were scrapped, and coalesced into a Nigerian police force, one central Nigerian police force, with hierarchical order coming all the way from the then federal capital, which was in Lagos. at the time with an Inspector General of Police, and then you have Commissioners of Police in the states, in the regions, and subsequently the states were created by General Yakubu Gowon, then who was the head of state, and then Commissioners of Police were also appointed. So you had an Inspector General of Police, Deputy Inspector General of Police, Assistant Inspector General of Police, and all the way down to State Commissioners of Police, Deputy Commissioners of Police, Assistant Commissioners of Police, Chief Superintendent of Police, and all the way down to inspectors and the constables, sergeants, inspectors, and the constables. That, briefly, is what the history of the Nigerian
police force is like. Centered upon. Okay, let me come to you, Honorable Member, sir. I'd like to find out from you, talking about the state police, we have a federal police force that has been in existence for quite some time. Why do you think it's imperative for a state to have its own police force away from the federal police?
Let's just take a look first at the Nigeria, the legal framework.
Okay, the legal framework.
Legal framework.
Of the police force?
No, of Nigeria.
Of Nigeria, okay.
Nigeria. Legal framework of Nigeria actually starts with the constitution, which is the ground norm. Constitution, like the SAR says, recognizes the existence of a police force. And then under the laws of the Federation, you have the Police Act, which now gives that Inspector General of Police to make specific regulations for the activities of the police. But structurally speaking, it's no longer possible and feasible and practical to have a federal police take care of specific issues that will arise from specific areas in Nigeria. A typical example is this. One Inspector General of Police over 774 divisional police offices. One Inspector General of Police over 36 or 37 commissioners of police. And then you have a central pool system where you distribute and send divisional police officers to the various local governments, no longer feasible. Recently in Abi, I got introduced to a new DPO who is from Plateau State, from Lantan. He was arriving in Abi for the first time in his life. And is coming to become the divisional police officer in Abi. One of the critical factors you need in order to be able to combat crime is your understanding of the environment, the culture of the people, and the way they live. You cannot do that. Something they call inner triangulating. You cannot understand what the crime history is in Abi if you're arriving for the first time in your life, maybe at the age of 46, to become a divisional police. And the issue is that we are taking it as a political issue. It shouldn't be political. The police force is doing its best, but there are obvious cracks in the implementation of crime management in Nigeria. And that is why we are duplicating it by creating other agencies that we should not create. We are having civil defense. Why are we creating civil defense? Because of the inability of the police to tackle some issues.
Okay.
We are now having even the
effectively, not excluding, you know, the challenges we're facing with complex insurgencies, because the perpetrators of these criminal activities are actually from those communities, you know, and the members of those communities know them. Now, there are two possibilities. A criminal element is going to be perpetrating a criminal act in the community where he lives, or he's going to go outside of that community. Whichever way, whether outside or inside, he's not coming from outer space. He's coming from somewhere. And the people from that environment, if they are vigilant and conscious, should be able to know who this is, who this criminal element is, and be able, you know, to act proactively in terms of working in collaboration with other law enforcement authorities. Let's even take the United Nations, you know, standard of the number of policemen in terms of proportion or ratio, number of policemen to persons, to, you know, population. The requirement is one policeman to 400 persons.
400 persons.
400
yeah.
persons. Now, we have a population of about 167 million Nigerians as of the last count, which was October or November 2011. Now, if you take over 300 policemen, which is what we have, and then you do a little bit of, you know, arithmetical equation, then you clearly understand that, you know, we do not have sufficient human factor for the purposes of law enforcement. Little wonder we continue to have a lot of security challenges, but we just need to, you know, step up our strategy in law enforcement and crime fighting, and, you know, face the reality of the day and stop living in denial, you know, in so many ways. You know, I think that's going to help us. And the people who are afraid, you know, who argue against the police, some of the points they put forth, are not strong at all.
Okay.
For example, they talk about the possibility of the fact that the police may be misused by, you know, political elements. In the present federal system, they are not being misused. How was Ngige abducted and taken out? By who? Yeah. Was it a state police or federal police?
Okay.
You know, you have several other instances like that. So the reality of the present day security challenges far outweigh such mundane arguments about their being used by political elements. But by and large, how it works or does not work well all depend upon the statutes.
Wonderful, sir. Okay, honourable members, I'd like to find out from you, from everything the SA has said, the objectives of establishing a state police cannot be overemphasized. But then if we're looking at the state police establishment, not compromising standards, how would a state sustain the standards and the regulatory framework of the state police body? How would that be done?
I think in a modern governance system, which is what we have, generating information, managing the information and drawing up a strategy on how to go about the formation of the state police is the easiest thing anybody can do. How do we start? First of all, we already know the population of Crossover, 3.something million people. We know the number of council wards that we have. We know the number of local governments we have. We know the number of communities we have. We know the number of development centers that we have. And we already have our data of the crime transition, where you have issues and all that, high volatile areas and all that. Now, if that is provided for in the constitution that any state that desires to have a state police can go ahead, I believe that Crossover will be one of those states. First of all, look at the responsibility that the state government is saddled with during the period of the Calabar Carnival.
Okay.
And the issues that come up in the Calabar Carnival, and tourism generally, is that of ensuring that you protect both the citizens and the visitors who come for that event. Government has a lot of responsibility, and a lot is paid to ensure that that is done. Number two, the state government is even involved in funding the federal police in the states, buying vehicle, buying equipment, and a lot of other incentives that is provided. And what that happens is that you're giving resources to somebody you cannot control and somebody you cannot manage. You cannot give them timelines. You can't give them instructions. They have to take instructions from Abuja. So that is part of the area. You look at when we had issues with elections, we said, okay, provide for state independent electoral commissions. We have that now. And we have local government election running based on the states, depending on when they decide that that should go on. So that should happen. I don't think that funding will be an issue, because within the state system, in Crossover State, we run the medium-term expenditure framework. We have the fiscal responsibility law, we have the public finance management law, and we have the fiscal strategy paper, which is presented to the State House on a quarterly basis of how much crossover has generated, what it should be spent, and our priority areas. What we just need to do is to appropriate that and provide the state police and the management of crime as an important factor. That we have the Office of the Special Advisor on Security is to try to create a bridge between the various federal agencies who are managing crime in crossover states. And that shouldn't happen if we have a state police in place. The highest that will happen, the Commissioner of Police will definitely be a member of ESCO. That a budgetary arrangement will be made. It will even help us take away the pressure we are facing with unemployment of youths. A lot of the graduates, we can take them up and they will join the crossover state police force. And then they will be trained, properly trained, and they will understand that we need to domesticate crime in crossover state. We won't be dealing with a situation where you have to send somebody, like I emphasize again, you send somebody from Katsina to. Once we're able to manage security, we can generate more money. Crossover is able to do a lot because the crime situation in Crossover is low. And that's low because of the strategy that the state government has put in place. You know, for a long time, we Crossoverians are known to be people who are very peaceful. Even when we have very high crime situation in Crossover, when you look at it, most of them are not non-Crossoverians who commit this offense. So we're having that, but we're beginning to have a surge in the number of people who come into crossover. I was looking at the data from National Planning Commission, and crossover is ranked as fifth in the number of states that is inhabiting the highest number of non-crossoverians. That means that you have a lot of people from Akwa Ibom in crossover, a lot of people from Imo State, these neighboring areas. So one of the challenges we are going to have going down that lane is that in the course of time, you begin to have a lot of issues coming up, a lot of foreign crime, so to say, beginning to happen. We're beginning to have pockets of issues relating to some offenses that you know under normal circumstances you won't hear in crossover. And we need to be prepared to tackle that. Now, what we need to do is to ensure that those who are coming for the Calabar Carnival will have the privilege of knowing that apart from coming for Carnival, you will also find Calabar as a place where you can get the best medical consultation and treatment. India is doing that, other countries of the world. And in Nigeria, the World Tourism Committee also rated that the only state that can do that for now is crossover state. We believe that will be high revenue enough for government. We believe that if we follow that issue well, government is going to earn a lot out of that. So we have to be prepared to handle the human challenges, the security situation.
Wonderful. He's talked about the enabling environment in Cross River State. I mean, the serene atmosphere for people to come and invest and all of that. But looking at so many other states, you initially, when we had this conversation, you said there were so many states that have actually concurred to the idea of establishing the state police. Now, how well prepared is Cross River State to enforce this? Establishment of a state police. Is Cross River State actually really ready to stand up to the challenges?
Well, to begin with, Cross River State is a model state.
Yes.
A model state in every respect. Our crime index is the lowest. Our environment is the cleanest. Talking about funding, I don't think that would be a big problem for a number of states.
Okay.
Which may be interested in having state police. Take Lagos State, for example. I don't see how funding a state police would be a problem to Lagos State. As we speak, the rapid response squad in Lagos has about over 600 vehicles. They have aircraft. They have, they have vessels in the waterways, and they have bikes. They procured over 1,000 AK-47 and ammunition, supporting the Nigerian Police Force, Lagos State Command, in their law enforcement activities, all of which is very expensive, you can see the same thing for River State. I think River State is more than prepared to have their own police force. I believe the same thing for Delta State, the same thing for the number of states. I can't be so sure about, states in the north. Some of them, yes, well, can do so, like Kano State, for example.
Okay.
It's a matter of a budgetary provision and fiscal discipline. But well beyond that, I think that it's also discretionary in terms
okay.
of political discretion.
Okay.
So there's no question about the fact that, if we have the go-ahead in terms of statutory provision, we would be able to fund it and, it would do extremely well. No question at all about that. And if we continue to pursue our security philosophy of zero crime tolerance. The answer, backbone, one of the things that would help us sustain this would be the state police.
Wonderful. Thank you very much for the time, sir. I actually wish we had some more time to talk about this subject, but definitely there should be another edition to emphasize more on the state police. Thank you very much for the time, sir. Okay, I've been talking with the state security advisor in person of Mr. Ekwene Brassey. Thank you so much. And I've also been talking with Honorable John Gall Lebo, the member representing Abbey State constituency. It's good to have you in the studio again, sir. Okay, security, of course, you know, is of topmost priority to everybody in Cross River State and indeed Nigeria as a nation. And then come to think about it, the people who go about perpetrating different kinds of evils in different states in Nigeria, I mean, there's need to beef up our security. There's need to beef up our security, and that is why Security Alert, the program, gives you the kind of awareness you need to have about the challenges and issues that bother around security. We'll definitely be back next week with a fresh and exciting edition. So we urge you to always keep to this program, Security Alert, at this time on the station. My name is Wofai Samuel. I'm signing out. Bye.